he was very careful. He avoided as much as possible the Israeli reports. And if at all he mentions one, then he comments on it. Not only Israeli reports, but even some hadith which he cites, and he finds that they are not acceptable, he does not accept it. He makes a comment. He will say that this is a munkar, unacceptable hadith. This is a gharib, strange hadith.
Mm-hmm.
And he sometimes gives the reason why it is not to be accepted, because one of the reporter in it is not a very authentic, very reliable one. That is Tafsir Ibn Kathir. So we said that Tafsir bil-Mathur lost ground in front of Tafsir bil-Rai at, say, 4th, 5th century. But we come across a name, a man, who was just like Tabari in his knowledge. He also wrote a book in history and also compiled a book of Tafsir. And he tried to make his book of Tafsir, Tafsir bil-Mathur, based on riwayat, based on traditions. Mm-hmm. But he was very careful. He was a good scholar of hadith as well. He was very careful. He avoided as much as possible the Israeli reports. And if at all he mentions one, then he comments on it. Not only Israeli reports, but even some hadith which he cites and he finds that they are not acceptable, he does not accept it. He makes a comment. He will say that this is a munkar, unacceptable hadith. This is a gharib, strange hadith.
Mm-hmm.
And he sometimes gives the reason why it is not to be accepted, because one of the reporter in it is not a very authentic, very reliable one. That is Tafsir Ibn Kathir.
Mm-hmm.
Muhammad Ibn Ismail, his name was Ismail Ibn Amr Ibn Kathir, who died in 774 of Hijra year, and he is well known as Ibn Kathir. So, since he had very good knowledge of hadith, his method is very simple and very good. And the book is only in 4 volumes, without any chain, with like Tabari, and without any repetition here and there. What he does, he again mentions some verses of the Quran, then gives some brief meaning, and then supports it by reports. He will try to get a report from the Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam, a marfu hadith, a prophetic tradition, and he cites it. And I noted that mainly he cites the hadith from the way of Imam Ahmad. Ahmad has his own musnad, so he will cite through him, give full chain, and then bring the hadith. And if the hadith is also in Bukhari or Muslim, which are considered to be the most authentic source, he will refer to them, say that this is reported also by them. So he quotes first from Ahmad, sometime he quotes from Tabarani, very late source of hadith, but he gives always full chain.
Mm-hmm.
And then gives his opinion and rating of the hadith as he understands.
Mm-hmm.
So he first goes to the Prophet to see any information available from him. If there is nothing, then he goes to Sahaba, companions. Abdullah ibn Abbas,
mm-hmm,
is there always. Ubay ibn Ka'b, Abdullah ibn Mas'ud. And after that, he goes to the Tabi'un.
Mm-hmm.
After that, he goes to Tabi'un, Mujahid and others.
Mm-hmm.
So he goes in this way. So as a matter of fact, first he quotes, before going to the Prophet to find a hadith, he is trying to find an ayah, a verse from the Quran which can cast light on this, on the meaning of this ayah.
Mm-hmm.
So he wants to collect or gather similar verses which can help one another in giving us the proper meaning. So it is considered really a very good source for Tafsirul Quran bil Quran.
Mm-hmm.
Tafsir of the Quran, mm-hmm, by the Quran.
Mm-hmm.
So he first goes to the Quran and then tries to get some material to help him. After that, he moves to the Prophet, and this is the way which, of course, scholars of Islam agree on it, that the very first and basic source for any teaching in Islam is the Quran. If anything is not available in the Quran, then a person should go to Hadith, and after that, of course, he can use any opinion from any source or can use his own reasoning and exercise ijtihad. So this is what Tabari, Ibn Kathir does. First goes to the Quran, then goes to the Prophet, then goes to the Sahaba. And then he sometimes uses his own reasoning, his own ijtihad, his own understanding of the Quran. So the book is very simple and very good. And it is very popular. I mean, it is as popular as Tabari's book is. So it is considered the second book after Tabari. Right? Yes, I mean, he tried as much as possible to avoid Israeliyat, but, you know, it seems that the Israeli reports, they are so interesting and so forceful that even how much a person tries to avoid, he sometimes is, you know, moved to take it and to accept it. So people noted that in Tafsir of Ibn Kathir, also we come across some of these reports. But in most of these places, Ibn Kathir gives his judgment that that is a report from Israeliyat. We should not bother about it. Then the question is that why did he quote it? Why did he include in the book? But anyhow, he did it, but he gave warning. He spoke. A very few places where he quoted a report which did not make sense and then passed without making any comment. So there are very few. So some abridgment were made for his book, you know, by many people, because it became very, very popular because of the man himself. He was very pious, very religious, very righteous person and very knowledgeable. So his book was also summarized, abridged by many other scholars, and one of the abridgment is translated in English, which is available now.
I just wanted to ask, did they both live during the same period?
Tabari was in fourth, he died in the early fourth century. He died in 310. After four centuries came Ibn Kathir. Ibn Kathir died in 774. So he was very late. But of course, he must have seen the book of Tabari, and he was a student of Ibn Taymiyyah. Ibn Kathir was a student of Ibn Taymiyyah who praised the book of Tabari. So he must have read the book of Tabari and must have learned from his methodology to be used in his book.